characterization of all versus nothing arguments for stabilizer states. Please go ahead whenever you're ready.
All right. Okay, that's better. Okay. So thanks to the organizers for this opportunity. Thank you all for coming. So I'm going to talk about complete characterization of all versus nothing arguments for stabilizer states. This is joint work with Samson, Rui, and Simon, who are all here at the conference. So let me start by. So let me start by giving some introduction on all versus nothing arguments. With the term all versus nothing, we refer to a class of contextuality proofs that rests on the derivation of an inconsistent system of parity equations. So the first instance of an all versus nothing argument was introduced by Mermin. This is the original paper, and it was used to prove strongly contextual behavior in the empirical model obtained by applying power measurements to a GHS state. Since then, many other studies with instances of this type of contextuality proofs have appeared in the literature, and they now represent one of the most widely used proofs of contextuality in quantum theory. So recent work by Abramsky and others has provided a general and abstract framework for all versus nothing arguments. Exists in the abstract level of sheaf theory, but we're not going to need any sheaf theory today. So one of the motivations for this type of abstraction is to characterize all the quantum states which give rise to maximal degrees of non-locality and contextuality. So today I'm going to give a partial answer to this question in the case of stabilizer states. So I'll start by recalling the original argument used by Mermin, because this is going to be a good guide for the rest of the talk. So first of all, just recall the definition of the Pauli matrices. These have been introduced by Simon's tutorial on Monday, but it's always good to refresh memory. So these are dichotomic observables with eigenvalues plus or minus one, and they satisfy the following equations, namely their square gives the identity and the anti-commute. Okay, so now we consider a tripartite measurement scenario where each party can perform a measurement either x or y on their respective qubits of the GHS state. And of course, when they do so, they obtain as an outcome one of the eigenvalues of their corresponding Pauli, so plus 1 or minus 1. But for convenience throughout this talk, I will relabel plus 1 and minus 1 with 0 and 1 respectively. And since we're going to be dealing with products of joint outcomes, we're going to use addition modulo 2 instead. So our outcome set is going to be Z2. This is, everything is equivalent, just for convenience. So we can summarize part of the of this empirical model by looking at this partial possibility table. So on the left-hand side, you see four contexts, so four possible choices of measurements for each of the three parties. And on the right-hand side, we have all the joint outcomes that are possible according to the empirical model. So wherever you see a 1, it means that the corresponding event is possible, and if you see a 0, it means that it is not possible. So for instance, this event here, which is the one where the three parties have decided to measure x, is a possible event. So it is possible that Alice, Bob, and Charlie, all three choose to perform x and they all obtain 0, while it is never possible that Alice and Bob obtain 0 and Charlie obtains 1. So if you look at this table, you'll notice that, for instance, in the first row, so for this context here, the only possible events are the ones where an even number of 1s appear in the joint outcomes. While for the remaining three contexts, the only possible events are the ones where a not number of 1s appear. So we can actually characterize this this table with the following parity equations. So for each measurement, we have a variable that I denoted with the name of the measurement with a bar to distinguish it from the measurement. So x1 bar means it's a variable in z2 for the outcome of the measurement x1. So these four equations characterize this table above. And if you look at them closely, you'll see that on the left-hand side, every variable appears twice, while on the right-hand side, we have an odd number of ones. So since these are equations in Z2, if we sum them, we obtain 0 equals 1. So what this tells us is that it is impossible to find a global assignment of outcomes to measurement that is compatible with the events that are deemed possible by the empirical model. And by definition, this means that this model is strongly contextual. As I said, Abramsky and others' work has generalized this setting to the abstract level of sheaf theory, and I just want to give you an idea of how this is done. We can generalize this basic example from Merman to a general scenario XM, where X is a set of measurement labels and M is a collection of jointly performable. It's a collection of contexts, but in this case, contexts don't have to be maximal. So M contains sets of measurements that are jointly performable. So suppose we have a general empirical model. So again, here I'm using the sheaf notation, but it's not really important. So EU is a probability distribution on the events at each context. So we can associate to the model E an XOR theory, which I'm going to denote by T plus here, which is defined as follows. So suppose we have a set of jointly performable measurements. So we just generalize what Merman did. So if the support of EU only contains joint outcomes of even parities, meaning that the only possible events are the ones where an even number of ones appear, then the theory will contain this assertion here, which is just a very natural generalization of what we did before. So for each measurement in U, we associate a variable x bar in Z2, and the sum of these outcomes has to give zero, because there's an even number of ones. And of course, if we have the other case where the support of EU only contains joint outcomes of odd parity, then the sum must give 1. So now we can define the notion of AVN. So we say that the model is AVN if the theory, the XOR theory, is inconsistent. And we have a straightforward consequence, the proposition, which is that if an empirical model is AVN, then it is strongly contextual, precisely because the inconsistency of the theory means that these equations they don't admit any solution, so it is impossible to find a global assignment of outcomes that is compatible with the model. So this is a very general setting. It applies to any sort of abstract notion of empirical model, but we want to really focus on quantum theory today, and it turns out that stabilizer quantum mechanics is a nice framework to see how this type of arguments appear in quantum theory. So some part of this have already been presented before, but I'm just going to recall some of the main definitions. So the main notion we'll need is the one of the Pauli N group, which is constituted by sequences of Pauli operators. So these PIs here are either X, Y, Z, or the identity with a global phase alpha. So a member of the Pauli N group is the choice of Pauli measurements for N parties. So in that sense, it corresponds to a context. The group EN acts on the Hilbert space of N qubits, which are denoted by HN, with the following action. And we can use this action to define for every subgroup S of PN, the vector space VS, the subspace of HN VS, which is given by all the states that are stabilized by all the elements of S. Wow, okay. I think I'm going to need a charger here. it doesn't have... Oh, it does. All right, sorry. Okay, hopefully it's good. So This is an important remark. So subgroups of the Paulian group that stabilize non-trivial subspaces of HN must be abelian. They must contain only elements with global phase plus or minus one. Such subgroups are called stabilizer subgroups. So if we have a stabilizer subgroup of PN, then we can look at an empirical model associated to it, which is obtained by applying measurements in PN to one of the states that are stabilized by S. So this is exactly the kind of models we'll be looking at in this talk. So there is an important relation between a subgroup of PN S and the vector space VS, which is given by the following relation. So the rank of S is equal to K if and only if the dimension of VS is 2 to the n minus K. So what this means in particular is that if S is a maximal stabilizer subgroup, meaning that the rank of S is n, then there is only one state up to a phase, which is stabilized by all the elements of S, and such a state is called a stabilizer state. So now I'm going to show you how subgroups of PN induce XOR theory exactly the same way I've shown you before, more abstractly. So to see this, suppose we have one Pauli P here, and suppose I have a state psi which is stabilized by P. So by the remark I gave you before, this means, since of course, well, I forgot to say that psi is non-zero, okay? So since this P stabilizes a non-trivial subspace of HN, we know that the global phase must be either plus 1 or minus 1. So I'm going to denote alpha by minus 1 to the A, where A is in Z2. So, well, okay, this is simply to say that P stabilizes psi according to the action I showed you before. So psi is an alpha eigenvector of P1 tensor Pn. And what does the expected value satisfy the following equation? And what this means, if we keep in mind that we have relabeled plus 1 minus 1 with 1 0, is that the only possible events are the ones where the joint outcomes have the only possible outcomes are the ones where the number of ones is has the same parity as A. So in other words, in more formal terms, an assignment of outcomes to these measurements determined by the context given by P, consistent with the model, has to satisfy the following assertion, which is exactly the same I just said. So for the same thing I just said. So for each Pauli, we associate a variable for its outcome, and the sum of all the variables for the Paulis that are not the identity has to give A. So now, given a subgroup S of Pn, we can associate an XOR theory, which is constituted by all these phi p, for all the p's in the subgroup S. And then we can reformulate again the notion of AVN, so we say that a subgroup is AVN if its theory is inconsistent. And again, we have quite a straightforward proposition that says that if a subgroup is AVN, then any empirical model associated to it is strongly contextual, again, because the inconsistency of the theory tells us that it is impossible to find a global assignment compatible with the model. So a natural question now is, how can we characterize the AVN subgroups of PN? This question was first addressed in a paper by Bramski and others that I mentioned before by introducing the notion of AVN triple. So an AVN triple is a triple of elements of PN which have global phases plus or minus one, and satisfy the following conditions, the following sort of, it's a combinatorial notion here. So for each I, at least two of EI, FI, GI must be equal. And this gives us three possible cases. And we need to have an odd number of each of them. So like the number of I's where EI is equal to FI and it's different from GI, and they're all different from the identity, is odd. And same for the case where EI is different from FI and equal to GI, and same for the remaining case. So just to give an example, the original Mermin argument that I showed you before at the beginning of this talk is based on the following AVN triple, and you can check that it is an AVN triple. So first of all, these three polys here, so the polys are the rows of this sort of matrix notation. Each of them has global phase plus one. You see that for each column, there are two polys that are the same. And you can see that there is exactly one instance of each of these cases. So all the three conditions are verified, condition two, three, and four. Right, so what they showed in the paper is that AVN triples provide a sufficient condition for an AVN argument. So in particular, they showed that if a subgroup S contains an AVN triple, then it is AVN. But what's interesting is that every AVN argument that has appeared in the literature can be seen to come down to exhibit an AVN triple. So they formulated a conjecture, the AVN triple conjecture, which says that a subgroup S is AVN if and only if it contains an AVN triple. So what I'm going to do next is I will prove the AVN triple conjecture in the case of maximal stabilizer subgroups, which again correspond to stabilizer states. And I also actually want to give you an idea of the proof, because the proof is not particularly complicated once we have established the right framework. And the right framework turns out to be the one of graph states. Now again, Simon has explained a little bit about graph states in his tutorial, but let me just give the main definitions again. So graph states are special types of multi-qubit states, and they're represented by graphs. So how does this work? We have an undirected graph G, and for each vertex of the graph, we associate a Pauli in the Pauli group on number of qubits equal to the number of vertices of the graph, with global phase plus one, and the components are defined as follows. So if V is equal to U, we have an X. If V is in the neighborhood of U, we have Z and an identity otherwise. And we define the graph state G, associated with the graph G, as the unique state stabilized by the subgroup generated by all these elements. So let me give you two simple examples that are going to be important later on. So the first example is this triangle graph, so a complete graph on three vertices. So here I have three vertices U, V, and W, and so we have three generators. So the first generator GU has an X corresponding to the vertex U and Z corresponding to V and W, because V and W are both in its neighborhood. And exactly the same happens for the remaining two, because of course everything is symmetric. Another example is the following. So a star graph on three qubits centered in this case at U. So the generator corresponding to U is exactly the same as before, because locally at U nothing has changed. But if we look at the generator associated to V, so it has of course an X corresponding to vertex V, it has a Z corresponding to U because U is in the neighborhood of V, but it only has an identity corresponding to W because there's no edge connecting the two. And of course the same is true for GW. So now, why am I looking at graph states? So there is this very important result in Schliegermann that says that any stabilizer state is local Clifford equivalent to some graph state. For instance, a GHZ state on, here I said n qubits, but should be 9, I think, here. I mean, it's general for n qubits. So a GHZ state defined on n qubits is local Clifford equivalence to the graph state associated to a star graph. These two states are, the states corresponding to this graph is equivalent, LC equivalent to GHZ, and it's also LC equivalent to the complete graph on n qubits. So just to give you an idea of why this is true, it is quite easy, this part is quite easy, sufficient to apply a Hadamard gate to all the qubits except one, and you immediately obtain a state which is a graph state centered at the vertex corresponding to the qubit where we haven't applied anything. This part here is a bit more complicated. It relies on the notion of local complementation. So local complementation of graphs is an independent notion of graph theory, which has been proved to be equivalent to local Clifford equivalence between the corresponding graph states. So why this example is important? Because, well, if we go back to the previous slide, well, these are a complete graph and a star graph on three qubits. So we immediately know that these two graph states are local Clifford equivalent to a tripartite GNZ state. This is going to be quite important later on. Right, so again, why graph states are important? Because both contextual properties and all versus not, and avian triples are preserved under, well, actually local Clifford operations. So for our purposes, we can look at graph states without any loss of generality. So now we're ready to present our main results, so the avian triple theorem. So the first part of the result is exactly the proof of the avian triple conjecture in the case of maximal stabilizer subgroups. So a maximal subgroup S of Pn is avn if and only if it contains an avian triple. But actually there are a couple of interesting consequences that are immediately clear once we look at the graph state formalism, which is that the avian argument can actually be reduced to one concerning only three qubits. So no matter how many qubits we have, the avian argument can always be derived by just looking at three qubits. And another interesting aspect is that the state induced by the subgraph for these three qubits is actually local Clifford equivalent to a tripartite GNZ state. So in some sense, a tripartite GNZ state avian argument underlies any all versus nothing arguments for general stabilizer states. So let me give a sketch of the proof. So, well, okay, yeah, here I forgot to say that one direction was already proved. Well, I said it before, but so the direction, so if the subgroup contains an avian triple, then it is avn, was already proved in the previous paper. So now suppose we have a stabilizer state S, and without loss of generality, we can suppose that it's actually a graph state for some graph G. So we have two possible cases. The first case is where the maximal degree of G is strictly smaller than 2. But this means that the state G is just a tensor product of 1 qubit and 2 qubit states, which are known not to be enough to realize prime contextuality, so we don't have to care about this case. And we're only left with the case where there is at least a vertex with degree 2, or at least 2. So again, we have two further cases. The first one is the following. So we have our vertex U that has at least 2 neighbors, V and W. It might have more, we don't know. The first case is where V and W are actually related by an eng, in which case the corresponding subgroup is given by these Paulis. So locally here, the first three columns here are exactly the same I showed you before. And for the remaining n minus 3 qubits, we have either I or Z, depending on whether the corresponding vertex is related by an edge or not to the vertex UVW. And, well, it's quite clear, if you look at the GUGVGW, that they constitute an avian triple. So in this case, we do have an avian triple. So the only case left is the following one, which is the one where V and W are not related by an edge, in which case the stabilizer subgroup is given by this expression. Again, the first three columns are exactly the same I showed you before, and for the remaining n minus 3, we only have R or Z. In this case, we have to do a little bit more work, but it's easy to show that if we take GU, GUGV, and GUGW, we do have an avian triple, so we always have an avian triple. So this is pretty much the whole proof of the theorem. So to conclude, I want to give, of course I forgot to say, but this is just a proof of the avian triple conjecture. So how do we know that we also have this other the possibility of reducing to three qubits? So of course, as you can see from this very simple proof, we can actually reduce the argument to just the three qubits corresponding to these triangles here, essentially. So in that sense, we can reduce the Irving arguments to one that just involves three qubits. And because of what I told you before, the subgraph induced by these three qubits is, in both cases, local Clifford equivalent to a GNZ state. So that's the whole proof, essentially. So to conclude, I'd like to tell you why this can be useful. Of course, well, it has some theoretical significance, but you can actually apply it to understand better avian arguments. So for instance, we can say take advantage of the combinatorial properties of avian triples to derive a closed formula for the number of avian triples in Pn. So to give an idea of the number of avian arguments for n qubit stabilizer states. Well, the formula is this one is quite horrible, so just to give you an idea, for n equals 3, it's 1728. We have more than 150,000 for n equals 4, and for n equals 5, it goes already over 8 million. But you can actually do better than this and use the check vector representation of elements of Pn to derive a computational method to actually not only count, but actually identify all the avian triples and, of course, the corresponding avian arguments. So if you're not familiar with the check vector representation of elements of Pn, essentially to any element of Pn, we can associate a check vector, so a vector of dimension 2n in Z2, which is defined as follows. It's not really important now. What's important is that every check vector completely determines P up to phase, but we know that the phases we're interested in are either plus 1 or minus 1, so we just artificially give them plus 1 or minus 1 to count all the possibilities. And of course, using this representation, the problem of finding avian triples becomes much, much easier to actually implement. And we implemented in Mathematica this idea. Like, I mean, of course, we translated all the conditions for an avian triple into these check vector representations, and we were able to find all the list of avian triples for n equals 3 and n equals 4. Potentially works for any n, but we need a little bit more computational power that my tiny laptop can provide. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. The techniques and the kind of setup that you presented seems to be specific to Z2 valued AVN arguments.
Yeah, that's true. So I should probably make a remark here. So it's true that the general framework for all versus nothing arguments developed by Samson, Rui, and everyone else that I mentioned before actually generalizes this AVN arguments for general rings, so not only Z2. So probably here I should have said AVN arguments. The AVN arguments that appeared in the literature are all in Z2. So it's true that it's not a full characterization. It's a full characterization of all versus nothing arguments in Z2. So yeah.
Have you given a talk as to how the AVN triple idea can generalize to other rings? And
no, but it's a good idea.
Other questions?